the Apollo's Associate Director of Community Programs and the producer of this Apollo Uptown Hall, Mr. Ade Williams. So now that I got you warmed up for Mr. Ade Williams, you know what you gotta do when it's your time to clap again. All right, what's up, y'all? What's up, what's up, what's up? What's up, y'all? Y'all good out there? Y'all good out there? All right, y'all look good from here. What's up, Apollo? Once again, my name is Manchild Black.
And my name is Monster Black.
And together we are the illustrious Blacks. And we thank you for being here at the Apollo. For the Apollo Uptown Hall. We got lots to talk about, lots to discuss, lots to get off our chest today. Are y'all ready?
Yes,
one more time. Are y'all ready? Yes, yes, yes. All right, people. Since we're about to start the program, listen up, listen very closely. Today's panel will be recorded, and your presence here equals consent to be a part of that recording. So, if you got warrants, or you're with the wrong person right now, you know what to do. No lawsuits. No lawsuits, because you've been warned. All right? Are we in agreement?
You All right. should know that now, because you've heard it twice.
But you know, some people just got here, so I want to make sure you know. I don't want no problems. I don't want no problems. All right. Anything else we got to talk about? Monster, since this is being recorded, please turn off your cell phones right now. Right now, turn off your cell phones. Are they off? Are they off? All right. I see someone. I see y'all. Thank you very much. I see you in the green. Yes, make sure you turn off your cell phones right now, because don't nobody want to hear your ringtone. Don't nobody want to hear that. Don't nobody want to hear the Bodak Yellow ringtone right now, right?
Right? Nobody got time for that.
Ain't nobody got time for that. So now, let's see, are we ready?
I think we're ready.
I think we're ready. Monster, you want to do the honors?
Let's try it again.
Wait, take your time, Monster. Take your time real quick, because I got something special. I got something special for this man right
now. Okay. Get it on up in there. Here we go. We're going to do something special for him. Like I said before,
keep going.
He is Apollo's Associate Director of Community Programs and the producer of this Apollo Uptown Hall.
Oh.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, are y'all ready? Give a warm round of applause to Mr. Ade Williams.
Give it up, give it up.
All right, I got introduced by the illustrious Blacks. That was really cool. Thank you, Blacks. And good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Apollo Theater, and thank you for joining us today. Most of you already know that the Apollo has been a cultural mecca for 83 years and counting. But beyond that, the Apollo is also a gathering place for people to connect and discuss what's on their minds. And this part of our legacy has attracted speakers to our stage, ranging from corner activists to United States presidents. Since the Apollo is an important community gathering place, we created Apollo Uptown Hall as an extension of that role. This series allows us to regularly engage in conversations that matter uptown and beyond. Now, in a year's time, this is our fourth Uptown Hall since September last year. We started off with the Uptown Hall debate viewing watch, where we showed on the big screen here the debate between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, and we had pundits here on stage talking about that. Some of y'all were in the house for that. Then in January, we had our Apollo Uptown Hall that celebrated the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. In February for Black History Month, we had a Uptown Hall that was discussing the use of the N-word, and that one was rather spirited, let's say. And now today, during what I will call a post-Obama period, we are presenting Apollo Uptown Hall Movement Required. I invite you all to listen to the conversation that will take place on this stage and over the airwaves today. And then I also invite you to move that conversation beyond the confines of the walls surrounding you. Join us on social media and tweet and do all of that. Let people know where you are and what you're into. We're a not-for-profit theater. I want to thank our many friends and supporters who help make programs like this possible here. And in a little while, you are going to see that each and every panelist and moderator who takes the stage today is special in their own right. And they always say, don't thank any individuals because you'll forget somebody, you'll offend somebody. But I am going to throw caution to the wind and give some extra thanks to some of them. I want to say right now, every panelist we have, everybody takes the stage, everyone who helped, they're all special and they're all pretty. But I'm going to give some extra thanks to a couple of them. So first, some behind the scenes information. Audience, organizing an event at the Apollo is not that different from when you were in high school and you tried to throw a party, a house party. You would invite somebody to the party, tell them the date and time and everything, and then what was the first thing that they would ask you? Come on, y'all, this is Apollo. What's the first thing? You invite somebody to the party, what's the first thing that somebody would ask you? So they eat something to drink, Well, when I would do it, I would invite somebody I wanted to have there, and the first question I would get would be, well, who else is going to be there? And I'd be like, well, I'm inviting you. And they'd say, yeah, but you know, who else is going to be there? Like, that would be the determining factor if they wanted to come to your party or not. Well, first person I want to thank is Mark Bamuthi Joseph, who you'll see in a little bit. Because when I approached Mark Bamuthi Joseph and invited him to be a panelist for this, the first thing he said was, bet, let's do it. What's the date? So thank you to Mark Bamuthi Joseph. Jason Osler, I want to give thanks to, you'll see him a little bit, director of Let the Fire Burn. I'm thanking him because I called him so many times over the summer that technically he should be getting co-producer credits. I want to thank Aisha Sekou, who you'll see out here for Street Corner Resources. Aisha Sekou is a sister who has had my back in this community for many, many years. And I want to thank Tamika Mowry. Tamika has quietly assisted the Apollo with our community programs for years, and whether she was recognized for it or not, she has consistently fought for this community long before she became a national name. All right, and on that note, it is my honor to introduce today's first moderator. He is the award-winning host, creator, and executive producer of the longest-running Black radio broadcast in the history of New York City. And I want to publicly thank him and say again that it was his broadcast of his community affairs talk show from this very stage here, every weekday during my youth, that inspired me to conceive and produce the Apollo Uptown Hall series. Courtesy of WBAI-FM, could you please all give a warm welcome to the radio griot, Imhotep Gary Byrd.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. As we always say, greetings in the name of God and the ancestors in whose footsteps we walk and upon whose ideas we fly. In the African tradition, one of the things that developed over the course of my time, having a chance to work with so many amazing elders like Dr. Ben, Dr. Clark, was that we would begin a program and always ask for the eldest person in the room for permission to speak. Now, that was okay when I was, you know, maybe in the industry for 30 years, and it was 40 years, and it was 50 years, and suddenly I became the oldest person in the room. So it changed the situation quite dramatically. But I'm very, very excited to be here today. This is really a home to me, as many of you know. We started doing work here in 1969 when I was with WWRL, and then we were graced, oh yeah, W Super 16. And I was mentored by the late Percy Sutton and Hal Jackson and brought to WLIB radio. And I was chosen from the airwaves to actually come here to this stage that we're on right here and to broadcast from this stage 4 hours a day live on radio. Some of you will remember that period of time. We did it for about 5 years, the Global Black Experience, live at the Apollo. I say that in terms of the kind of work that it was, that they had to literally drag us out of here. We were wiped out, but it was a great experience. I'm excited today for several reasons, because we're in a position right now with, I think, what is an amazing opportunity. And I say opportunity because I think there is a place where we often talk about unity, and then sometimes when we're in the midst of it, we don't really necessarily acknowledge that it's happening. And I think the opportunity that's occurring here was exciting, and for me to be a part of, is that we are a part of a multiple set of organizations that have come together today for this to happen. First of all, the world-famous Apollo Theater, which you know. You can give acknowledgement to that, which is now literally a community center. Also, WBAI Radio, where I do my broadcast Friday night, 6 to 8 p.m., and where you hear the illustrious blacks in the house doing their thing as well. And also an opportunity to, in this instance, salute the brothers and sisters who really make all of this happen. And I'm talking about you, the community. Give yourselves a big round of applause. If you remember, when I day said Apollo Uptown Hall movement required, the primary movement was for you to put yourselves in the seats, and you have done that. So again, give yourselves some serious energy because you showed up. And I do, wait a minute, I do understand there's some folks, some Philly in the house, and there's some Philadelphia. Let me hear y'all. What's up? Philly in the house? All right, we like that. This is an opportunity for us to come together, really, essentially, with what has been described correctly so as a community conversation. And it's a community conversation with folks who are making a difference, and really to also resurrect our awareness of a moment in history that has not received the attention that it deserves. And you know, obviously, I'm talking about the MOVE atrocity. And for us to look at what took place in Philadelphia, and I mean, some people don't travel a lot, but let's just say that if you wanted to go from Queens to the Bronx, I might beat you driving to Philadelphia. That's how close Philadelphia is. So Philadelphia is not some other city far away in the Northeast or someplace. These are our neighbors. These are our brothers and sisters who, in many instances, I have friends, they live in Philly and work in New York. It's turned into that sort of situation. So what occurred in 1985 is not something that occurred, you know, in some faraway place. It occurred right down the road, so to speak. And when I say that we have to look at its historical significance, let's look at it against the backdrop of the bombing of Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Let's see MOVE in that context. Let's see MOVE in the context of Rosewood in Florida. And let's also see MOVE in the context of Charlottesville in 2017. We've had many, really too many atrocities in between all of this, and the relationship between law enforcement and the black community continues to take a path that really divides this country literally every day. And we should never forget about those atrocities, but the bombing of MOVE in 1985 is of specific and special significance. Some of you know that We Shall Not Be Moved from Opera Philadelphia is coming here to the world-famous Apollo Theater. Y'all know about that, right? Do y'all really know? Put your hands together, because it's real. This is a creative version of the MOVE story that will actually be mounted on this stage. And the interesting thing of us having this program that we're doing today towards the end of September is that it's National Emergency Preparedness Month. Did y'all hear me? It's National Emergency Preparedness Month. And so while we're in solidarity with our brothers and sisters who have been hit by hurricanes in Houston, Texas, Florida, Cuba, Puerto Rico, the U.S. Virgin Islands, and on through the Caribbean, today we have a community conversation about another hurricane, the hurricane of police violence in our community, the hurricane of racism and poverty, the hurricane of racism that ultimately continues every day and now adds the face of fascism in 2017. So what we're going to do today is we're going to address those issues and at the same time introduce you to some brothers and sisters who are really doing what they do to make a difference. And again, we're excited for you brothers and sisters to be here and can't say enough for you taking time out of your schedules to be a part of the experience. So give yourselves another big round of applause. Back in 1985, there was a law enforcement attack on MOVE, Radical Black Community Organization, progressive, living in the heart of Philadelphia. Let the Fire Burn is an award-winning documentary that covers that confrontation. Let's start today's conversation with a clip from Let the Fire Burn. Let the Fire Burn. It's the award-winning documentary that covers the confrontation. Let's welcome the director of Let the Fire Burn, Jason Osdor, with us today on the world-famous Apollo Theater stage.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
As you can hear, and as you've obviously seen before, the film elicits quite an emotional level of reaction. Talk a bit about what led you to want to pursue doing this project.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, thank you to everyone in the Apollo, Ade, and all those people. It's a real privilege to work with these people and a real honor to be on the stage. I grew up in Philadelphia. To give away my age, I was about 11 when this happened. And, you know, I think when you experience something matters, and for me, this was the first news story that sort of pierced the bubble of childhood. Not everyone has that privilege, that bubble, but you know, childhood is often being sheltered by your parents, being told that the world is a fair place. And I think different generations, you know, a whole generation, well, my parents' generation talks about where were you when you learned JFK was shot. And I teach young people, and you know, they all mark 9/11 as that moment. Although we're actually starting to have college undergraduates who don't remember 9/11, which is mm-hmm. kind of crazy. But for me, it was that moment. It was that breaking of the childhood frame. And I think part of what makes that moment what it is you don't have the tools that adults have. This is not explained. I mean, there are partial explanations, but when you're a child, you don't have the frames of racism and police brutality. Like, you don't even have words to put to it. And so it just kind of, you know, breaks you a little bit. And then I think not very long after that, I left Philadelphia to go to college myself. And I realized very soon that this thing that had affected my psyche so powerfully, and I wasn't that close to the center of it, you know, at all, that people my age from other parts of the country had no idea, didn't even know what I was talking about. And this was only early 90s, right?
Interesting. Mm-hmm.
And so that really cemented this idea, that a vague idea that something, this history can't be forgotten outright. And then years later, I sort of gained the tools to tell the story, and was able, with a lot of help and support, to finish the film.
There's a place where one wonders in doing this type of project in terms of what you uncovered, and there's a whole range of different emotional dimensions, but also political dimensions that emerge as well. What was it like for you in the collection of that material, and what occurred when you finally unveiled this publicly?
Right. Well, did a lot of research, and a lot you don't see in the film. We made a decision to make the film crafted entirely from the archival record,
right,
which is an unusual decision for historical filmmaking. And we'd actually shot interviews. In fact, Ramona Africa is going to come out on the stage in a little bit, and we'd spent some time with her, and she'd given us, you know, generously sat with us to record her story, as well as other people. And I guess, you know, part of the thing was traditionally in historical documentary, you have people that reflect back and have great insights. And there was not a whole lot of movement, right? Like the people that we talked to 20 or 30 years later didn't really give us something new or different than they were likely saying 20 years ago, from whatever position they were coming from. So, you know, I don't think there was, creatively there were moments of revelation, but politically or investigatively, I think it was more about the detailed sifting to tell the story than any sort of discovery. And the reception has been good. I mean, you know, and complicated. You know, even I'm very glad that the incident is getting attention. I'm very touched when the people putting on the opera or anything like that contact me and say, you know, we used your film to get sort of set up or find our bearings in this. That to me is exactly what I want to happen. I want people to continue to tell the story, and if my film can help them get a starting point to tell it, that's what I would love more than anything. And I think, you know, a lot of people saw it. It's all relative. You know, I make documentary films, and so a successful documentary film, I think around 3 million Americans have seen this film.
Three. Okay.
And I that's considered wildly successful for a documentary, but let's be real, that's less than 1% of the population. Mm-hmm. So it's like, yeah, I think we moved the needle. Like, one of my big goals was to make this part of history, right? Like, the sense in which history is not what happens, it's what's written and what's remembered. And you don't solve that.
Yeah, we can give some energy to that, can we? Yeah.
Thank you. But I don't mean to say in any event that I made a movie and solved that. Like, that doesn't happen,
yeah,
right? You hit the drum once, and you hope that people are going to come behind you and keep hitting that drum. So it pleases me tremendously to have that happening. And I could go more about the reception, because there's different parts to it. It was different in Philly than it was in other places, et cetera, as you would expect. But, you know, sometimes it was heated, but sometimes you need that heat.
Absolutely. There's a place where, as these experiences in terms of production move over time. You said something in your conversation, and as an educator, it's interesting that there are some students of yours who don't remember 9/11. It is fascinating and somewhat frightening to realize that we have people, in some instances, in Philadelphia who actually don't remember MOVE.
Oh, I mean, and young people, certainly. And again, these have been some of the best moments. Community College of Philadelphia did a big program around the 30th anniversary of the event, and it, you know, similar to the feeling here, but onto the young people, and to hear young people of color in Philadelphia say, watching, you know, this event, learning about it, actually inspired me for the first time to do schoolwork because I wanted to, not because the teacher was telling me. I wanted to go learn about this. You know, that's really touching. At the same time, I had a colleague where I teach, a black man my age from Philadelphia. And I told him what I was doing, and he did, had never heard of it.
Understood.
Never heard of it, yeah.
We have a second clip. Why don't you set it up for our audience today?
Yeah, we're piecing things together to try to be as on point for today in this moment as possible. And so we're going to drop into what really, in a lot of ways, is the climax of the film. And I don't want to totally give it up, but films can't do everything. So at a certain point in a film, you pick what is your theme. Like, what are you really trying to say with this? And we were lucky that we made that decision, and we had some material and a scene that we felt like called out exactly what we were trying to say. And I don't think I have to say it because it's pretty precise in the clip.
From Let the Fire Burn. Wow. Let the Fire Burn. It speaks for itself. Thank you again, Professor Osdour. Please, a big round of applause for the professor as well. Give that real Apollo energy. That's right. No question. Anyone who has seen this film, I know that when I was watching it at home this week, you know, time goes by, you forget that you're supposed to eat or take care of errands or whatever and so forth, because it rivets you inside of the experience of seeing what actually is happening. And I say that because we can think about Black Wall Street or Rosewood, but we don't have the footage, okay? We don't have the blowback there to see exactly what took place. And when you talk about this situation and the issue of fire, and it is about fire, and in some instances, accusations of people actually somehow running back into the fire that we've heard. This sister joins us tonight as someone who walked out of the fire. I am pleased to introduce the Minister of Communication for the MOVE organization and the last survivor of the 1985 MOVE bombing. Apollo, please welcome Sister Ramona Africa. Yeah. That's right. Welcome, sister.
Thank you.
Right now, you and Birdie Africa, the child that we actually heard in the last clip, were the only survivors of this confrontation. And you can't help but notice in the clip, and I could hear members of the audience responding to the fact that you could hear the account that young Birdie gave really varies drastically, even dramatically, from the account that the police gave. And even perhaps more so in terms of interest is that that pattern is a pattern that repeats itself over the decades, whether we're talking about Philadelphia, New York, Baltimore, Los Angeles, Dallas, Houston, wherever. And certainly through some of the worst that we've seen, Abner Louima, Sean Bell, Eric Garner, Sandra Bland, Tamir Rice, all of that. What are your thoughts about that pattern that we continue to see happening police department after police department?
Well, first of all, I think it's very foolish to even expect the police or officials to tell the truth or be honest. I mean,
yes.
It's not gonna happen.
Yes.
It's not gonna happen. And particularly when you're talking about instinct. I mean, Father Paul Washington in that last clip, I think he made it pretty clear. He's like, I'm just trying to figure out what would cause somebody to go back
into a fight.
A blazing inferno.
Amazing.
It's not instinctive, it's not natural. Who would do that? You know, the reason, I know I came out twice, me and a couple of the children, Birdie being one of them, tried to come out hollering, we're coming out, we're bringing the children out, the children hollering, we're coming out, they're bringing us out, only to be met by a barrage of police gunfire. They never intended for anybody to survive that. Their intent when they came out there was to kill every living being in that house.
Lord, I mean,
it's just no getting around it. All of their actions speak right to it.
I talked earlier to Pam Africa. We were having a conversation, and she said something. Please, you can give energy for Sister Pam. But she said something that I thought was horrific. She talked about how in some instances that there were efforts by police to actually take people back into the ruins, literally, who, after they had been shot and killed, literally, but to take them back as if they were inside the burning house.
I have heard that, and what gives it some legitimacy is that the medical examiner's office, who examined bodies that were removed from Osage Avenue, they admitted, they said that some of the bodies had gunshot wounds in them. If that happened, it would have to have happened outside.
Yes.
So how did they get back inside, you know?
Amazing.
It was just some treacherous, treacherous stuff going on that day.
Wow.
I want
you to answer this question, and as they say, let it resound. Am I understanding that not one official was held accountable for the lives that were lost in that attack?
Not a one. And the point that MOVE makes, our family members, known as the MOVE Nine, on August 8th, 1978, when police attacked us again with one aim to kill everybody in our home, they failed, and in their fervor to kill off MOVE, they ended up shooting and killing one of their own fellow cops. They blamed it on MOVE. Nine of our family members were tried, convicted of murder, and sentenced to 30 to 100 years each in prison. One cop killed nine people with 30 to 100 years. Fast forward to 1985, and 11 MOVE people, five of them children, are murdered by police, and not one single person was charged or went to prison except me.
I want to make sure that we have a chance to answer or have you answer one of the questions that was submitted online for this Apollo Uptown Hall. It was Misha from Harlem. She wrote this. She said, I know that your work as an activist has continued. What advice would you want to share with the new generation fighting mass injustice?
Never ever accept what you know is wrong. Don't ever accept it. The other thing is to never, ever give in. To keep fighting for what's right. Times may seem hard sometimes. If you feel like you need a little break or whatever, take it. But never, ever stop fighting. And never, ever give in to what you know is wrong, no matter who that wrong is coming from.
Wow, wow. Regretfully, because of the way we're scheduled today, we've run out of time, but I do want to say this to you and those of you here. I want you to make sure that you're listening to our Friday night broadcast on WBAI. We come on 6 to 8 p.m. every Friday night. So Radio GBE. What we intend to do is to have Sister Ramona and Sister Pam Africa with us across in the month of October, and even we'll stretch to November if we have to give not only them a chance to have a greater platform of expression, but also for you to have a chance to talk with them directly. So that'll happen in the days ahead. Can we give our sister a big round of applause and appreciation as well? And here's something that should be exciting to you all. You can actually see Jason's film, Let the Fire Burn, in its entirety tomorrow, October 1st, at 5 p.m. at the Maisels. Now, interestingly enough, your tickets, I'm talking about your free tickets, for this program, will give you a 10% discount for that screening. And I just can't say enough about our sister coming here to be with us today. This cannot be a situation that has been without difficulty, to just remember it and to deal with the trauma of it. But she and Sister Pam have, I think, stood forward as soldiers to actually represent this movement in the future. And we thank you, sister, and we love you. Thank you so much.
I do it as much for myself as for an example for everybody else, because I have to look myself in the face every morning, every day.
Wow.
And I want to like what I see.
Well, sister, we love what we see. Thank you again, Sister Ramona Africa. And Jason Osdor, let's thank them both for being with us today. Well, today's conversation started with the specific confrontation, of course, of the amazing atrocity that happened with MOVE in Philadelphia back in 1985. We'll continue this discussion because, as we've said, that's not the only place, really, nor the only time, frankly, that there's been a, what do we call it, a negative confrontation between police and black folks. Y'all do understand that's not the only situation, right? You know that. Well, coming up, your moderator for the upcoming segment is a brother who is a newspaper columnist, an author, and the host of Wake Up with WURD on WURD AM and FM in Philadelphia. Please welcome my brother, Solomon Jones, to the world-famous Apollo Theater.
You know, when I think about the MOVE confrontation, I think about the fact that in 1985, I was a senior in high school. Now, I've just told you how old I am. Don't tell anybody. But at that time, we weren't as aware as our young people are now. And so as I look back at the way that we responded to that, like, oh, wow, that's really a shame. And then we kind of went on with our lives. I'm proud of the way that our young people are responding now to what they see with the police and with our communities and with justice. And so I am proud of our young people and proud of what they are doing and proud of the way that they are carrying this thing forward. So let's continue the discussion, because as we've said, that's not the only place and it's not the only time that we've seen a negative confrontation like this with police. We've also seen it in New York. We've seen it in Philadelphia and in Ferguson and in Florida and in Missouri and in Oklahoma and in places all across this country. And so we've assembled a distinguished panel of activists and professionals. So let's jump right in. And I'll start, Jerrica, with you. All right. Jerrica Richardson is senior advisor to the New York City Civilian Complaint Review Board, or the CCRB. We have in Philadelphia, of course, a police advisory commission that works, I guess, in much the same way that yours does. But a lot of places don't have any kind of civilian oversight for the police. Can you explain to us how the CCRB works and what it does?
Absolutely. Well, the New York City Civilian Complaint Review Board is the largest civilian oversight entity in the nation. We investigate, mediate, and prosecute members of the New York City Police Department for misconduct. So we have four areas that we take a look at. The first is force, abuse of authority, discourtesy, and offensive language. So that is our purview. What makes the New York City Civilian Complaint Review Board extremely unique is that we're the only review board across this country that independently prosecutes police officers for misconduct. And so our administrative prosecution unit... So our administrative prosecution...
Okay, let's settle down and give her a chance to answer.
All right. So we get about 4,500 complaints a year. And we, our administrative prosecution unit's only been around for the past 4 years. But I can tell you that we've seen a marked difference. So the Civilian Complaint Review Board's been around since 1993. It came into effect under the Deacon's administration. So prior to that, any types of complaints or misconduct, you had to go directly to the NYPD. So that's why it's important that we are independent. And I will say that in the year and a half before we had our administrative prosecution unit, zero cases went to trial. In the year and a half after, we had 167 that sent to trial. So it's very important that the community supports the Civilian Complaint Review Board.
Okay. All right. Go ahead. So Jerrica, here's the question that I would ask, because what we see in Philadelphia is that there aren't a lot of resources. In fact, the police advisory board is kind of starved because it doesn't have the resources to do the things that it needs to do. I don't know what the case is with the CCRB, but what I would ask is this. What are the policies that are in place with the NYPD that would stop something as catastrophic as MOVE from happening?
One of the things that's important for people to do is actually file complaints, because what we're doing here at the CCRB, in addition to investigating them and mediating them.
Yeah. Okay. Wait a minute, Jerrica. Okay. Listen. So we're gonna give her a chance to answer the questions, because we want to move forward with the conversation. We want to move forward with the conversation. And in order for us to do that, we have to have some kind of decorum, right? Y'all my people. Y'all are my people, black people. Can we have just a moment for the sister to answer the question? Okay, all right. So we're gonna move on. So I have a question from a member of the audience of one of the radio stations that's involved, and it is from LA, from Lennox. What should citizens do when they feel they are not being treated fairly by police? And Jerrica, that'll be another question for you.
So part of it is raise your voices. So what we do at the Civilian Complaint Review Board is not just investigate, mediate, and prosecute, which I think is important and it's crucial, but we need to create a record of what's going on. We are an administrative process. So what I'm telling you is, if you have an encounter with police officers that you feel uncomfortable with, you believe misconduct happened, you have three tools in your toolbox, right? If you believe that there is criminal, there's a criminal issue, then you can file criminal charges. If you believe that you are wronged and this is a civil issue, you have the right to file a lawsuit. So we're not taking that away from you. But what we were adding is, we're making sure that you're creating a record for that officer. It impacts their promotion within the police department. And you know, worst case scenario, it can result in the removal of that person from the police department. So one thing that we need to think about is making sure that we use all of our tools in the toolbox and making sure that, one, what the Civilian Complaint Review Board does is it raises policy issues. If there are things that are happening in the community and we're keeping track of how people are treated in Harlem versus how they are treated in Chelsea, right? So that is one thing that we do, and it gives us the opportunity, one, to speak to the police commissioner about what we're seeing on the ground and actually make concrete policy proposals. Some of those proposals are to the patrol guide. So we look at taser usage and a whole number of things. So what if we don't hear directly from the community about what's happening on the ground, we can't be an effective agency.
All right. So one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to give people a chance to answer the questions. Right? Because if we don't do that, we can't move forward. You don't have to agree, but you do have to show respect for this sister, right? For this black woman that's sitting here next to me. That's what you're gonna have to do. All right? So we're gonna move on. And thank you, Jerrica.
Oh, you're welcome.
Tamika Mallory, as a nationally recognized activist, you helped to organize the 2017 Women's March. You've been around the country. You've traveled from to numerous states for numerous causes, ranging from Trayvon Martin in Florida to Michael Brown in Missouri. From your observations, what do you think people need to do to challenge police brutality and overreach?
So first of all, I want to thank all of you, and particularly Ade, our brother who put this event on today, and mm-hmm. Apollo for having me to be here.
Absolutely.
I want to just make sure that I say to y'all, because I just can't allow what happened just now to continue without me speaking up about that. Jerrica is my sister. We work together. The system we know is all messed up, and CCRB is all messed up too, but the young lady is a good sister who's really trying to do good work, so I need y'all to give her a little bit of respect
today.
That's
right.
And we certainly need to challenge Jerrica and make sure we give her our recommendations and write it down. And I understand the frustration that's in this room, because when you ask the question, what can we do about policing issues, what we hear here, and I'm sure Jerrica understands, is the frustration that people are doing all those things. They're filing reports, they're marching, they're yelling, they're right. screaming, they're doing everything. And none of it is working because there is a systematic issue that is in place, and there is, period, point blank, systemic racism that exists within all the right. systems in right. New York City and across the country. So what do we do, right? Because there's been a rally every week, mm-hmm. and I'm the rally lady. I know how to put a rally together from beginning to end. If you call me and ask me about a rally, that's something that I do. But I recognize that the rallies are only going but so far. People do not necessarily respect the fact that we're rallying. It is good to bring attention to the issue. But right. where we're dropping off is that we're not understanding that all of these things work together. And if turnout is low in our communities when it's time for us to vote, that's a problem. And that is, in fact, happening. Some of us think that, well, I do vote, but we're not doing real work in our communities. And I've been talking about this all day, this local, hyper-local work to ensure that we're turning out in every election. Right. Because the school-to-prison pipeline is an issue also, and we're not showing up for school board elections. We're not showing up for district leaders' elections. We're not showing up for city council elections. We wait until it's time for the mayor to run, and then we all show up and think that somehow that's going to change the system. It doesn't work like that. We have to participate in every single process. Now, you may live in a state where police brutality is not really your issue. You know, maybe you have a person of color or not that is a very respectable police chief, and you don't have those issues in your area, but you care about what's happening in Ferguson, and you care about what's happening in New York and other places. Well, the reality of that is that we also have black folks, the black people in this room, in case you don't know, we have $1.3 trillion in spending power that we are not using to let people know that I'm pissed off about these issues. We are all disorganized and all over the place in terms of how we move. We're not moving as a block. We're not moving as a voting block. We're not moving as a financial engine. So I believe that what we have to do is start looking at our collective power and unity as the only answer. It is truly the only answer to how we're going to get through this. We have all the tools in our toolbox, but the toolbox has a few parts in this box and a few parts in that box. We got some stuff locked up in the closet. Yeah. There's some pieces in the kitchen in the junk drawer. And now it's time for us to get all the pieces, put them all on the table, and decide how we're going to make the move to build our house.
All right. All right. Thank you, Tamika. Thank you. So we were talking a lot about policing, and policing, of course, is a function of the government. And it always strikes me when we talk about it that we literally are paying our tax dollars to pay people salaries who kill us and walk away. And that's a serious issue. And it's not just an issue that can be handled by the government or by an agency that is a quasi-government agency, but it also needs to be handled in the community. And so this question, Jennifer Jones Austin, is for you. As CEO and director, executive director of the Federation of Protestant Welfare Agencies, in what other ways do our communities need to come alongside in order to make sure that we are better served by the government that we pay for?
Of you here, because first and foremost, we have to be engaged and we have to be informed, and then we have to activate. Fair? One of the things that often isn't talked about when we talk about law enforcement and when we talk about policing is the intersectionality, just putting it right out there, of race, crime, and poverty. And the fact that in America, 40% of crimes are attributed to poverty. Now, what that means is not that poor people are likely to commit more crimes just because they're poor. What we're really talking about is that a lot of crimes result from poverty, people not having enough food to eat. And so then they may rob a place to get some money to put some food on the table. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
We don't do enough in this country to look at the intersectionality between poverty and criminality and criminal justice involvement, and how we have over-policing in our communities, in our more impoverished community. But what we're not doing is providing the resources to combat poverty. So if you do not address poverty, you're never going to get to real issues of fighting criminal injustice.
Sister.
So
sister,
what this?
Give me a second. Sister, please. Respect your fellow black woman. Please do that.
Well, part of the challenge is that if you don't listen to me,
right,
you're not going to understand how all of these issues are intertwined, and so then you're not going to go out and do the activism that you really need to do. You can stand up. You can stand up and combat the police system every day, but if you don't understand how you've got perpetuating poverty policies that are in place to keep you down, you're never going to get ahead. And so you need to understand that you need to fight poverty while you're also trying to take on the police system. So what am I talking about? What am I talking about? What happens in our communities is we don't have access to high-paying jobs. We don't have access to quality education programs, right? We do not have access to the best hospitals. And so then we are impaired from getting ahead. So what we need to be fighting for is the right systems, mm-hmm. the funding that allows our children to be better educated, that allows our children to have the best health care possible, that allows families to be involved in the workplace and get the wages that they need to take care of their children, to take care of their grandparents, to take care of parents. And so what I'm talking to you about, whether you like what I'm saying or not, what I'm telling you is that you can stand up and complain all you want about policing, but if you don't also stand up and fight the systems that are seeking to keep you and us in poverty, then you're not going to get ahead.
Right.
And so you need to join with community-based organizations in your community that are trying to educate children better. You need to join with those systems that do not have the adequate funding for food, housing supports, all of those issues.
Yeah.
And get engaged.
Okay, so we got a couple minutes. Tamika, you had a follow-up on that.
Go ahead. I agree with Jennifer 100%, and it's not just poverty. There's a bunch of other issues that's happening in our community, and I agree that, I agree with the question of poverty 100%. Because we know that when we look at gun violence, even in our communities, we know exactly why this is happening. We have young people who are being given a gun and they're not being given food, and they're gonna find a way to eat somehow, some way. But I will say that there is also this overlying issue around the 13th Amendment, right? And how we're currently under the 13th Amendment, it says that we're still slaves if we commit a crime. That's basically what it says. I mean, it's written more eloquently than that, and Jennifer is like the super smart person here that can explain it better than me. But we know that the 13th Amendment currently says that if, in fact, you commit a crime, they can basically take you back to indentured servitude, which is why we have so many people caught up in mass incarceration. They're in the system. system. They're making products for corporations. They're getting paid $4 an hour. We know all the things that's happening. Well, why wouldn't they want to over-police our communities when they need the commodity of bodies going into the system? Mm-hmm. So we know that the overarching issue is that you may be a person who cares about police accountability, and you should stay in that fight. But there is nothing wrong with the idea that you may also need to be in the education fight. You may want to be in the gun violence fight. You may want to be in the poverty fight. There are so many issues happening in our community, and they are all based upon one thing. Black bodies is worth dollars. We are worth dollars and cents to someone. And if we allow the school system to fail, but we want to fight police brutality, it's not going to work. All these things are happening at once, and we have to be a well-oiled machine in order to address
them. Right, and I think, and absolutely, give her a hand. We have to understand that these systems are intersectional.
They are. Absolutely.
That, you know, if a child is suspended more than once, then that child is more likely to drop out. If that child drops out, the child's more likely to go to jail.
Exactly.
If the child go to jail, the child is more likely to go back. If the child is more likely to go back, their children are more likely to go to jail. It's a cycle. It's
right.
a cycle.
When,
so,
right.
so
when you have in New York City,
yeah.
when you look at the metro system, and 30% of the arrests in New York City are tied to jumping the turnstile, not paying your fare.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why are people not paying their fare? Because they don't have the money to pay the MetroCard fare. That's why you have to look at how all of these issues relate
right.
together, and you cannot right. treat it as a one-off.
Right, right. Yeah. And so let's talk about something that's going on now, and I'm gonna ask everybody about this. Mm-hmm. The NFL protests that are going on now, mm-hmm. right? That started with Colin Kaepernick deciding that he was going to take a knee because he didn't want to pledge allegiance to a flag for a country that is killing his people.
Right.
And now you have other NFL players, of course, taking a knee. And there's been a change in administration since that began. And now there has been a response to that. And I want to ask, and I'll start, Jerrica, with you. In terms of those protests, do you think that those protests can be effective in making change?
Absolutely. The important thing for all of us to do is actually stand up and raise our voices. And so when we talk about accountability, each and every one of us in this room is accountable. Whether you are a member of a faith leader, or you are a member of clergy, or you are the grandma down the street that saw children being harassed by police officers, everybody has to speak up. So I think one of the problems is, and unfortunately, we all are ready to speak up and stand up when something tragic happens. But what I want people to think about and focus on is that situation that's happening every day. When you're being stopped and asked to get out of your car, you're being searched improperly, someone is being discourtesy, CPR, that's on our police cars, courtesy, professionalism, and respect. If you don't point out every time some of those incidents happen, if you don't speak up, what happens is it snowballs into larger issues.
Okay.
So I agree with Kaepernick, and he is doing the right thing, but we need to raise these issues early on. We need to talk about them every single day.
Okay.
We can't just run out when the tragedy happens. What I want to do is prevent the tragedy, mm-hmm. and I want a community that is going to support me in raising these issues early on so we can get rid of the people that are actually causing the problem down the road.
We got 50 seconds. Go ahead, Jennifer.
Real quickly, those protests will be effective if they are able to endure and they have the stamina to keep it up. And they do not let the media or Donald Trump deflect the issue, right? Because we're not even talking anymore in the main about why Kaepernick, took a knee.
Mm-hmm.
Trump has allowed this to be turned into whether or not there's disrespect for the military.
Right.
Right? We have to get back to why he took the knee in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
So endurance, stamina, and keeping on the issue.
Okay, and Tamika.
I think all the people in this room are responsible for how we continue the Kaepernick protest. We are the ones that know exactly why he started. We're the ones with the issues in our community. So if we're on Facebook and other places saying, I'm still going to watch my football game, then we are a part of the problem.
All right.
And I think that our president calling people sons of bitches is the first reason why black women ought to be saying, you can go to hell.
That's right, because he's talking about y'all.
That's right.
Because if he's a son of a bitch, then what is he calling a black woman? Right. I want to thank everybody. Ade Williams is going to come up. Thank you so much, Pam.
Thank you all. All right, hope everyone's enjoying. A couple quick announcements. First off, we live in, I think, the greatest city in the world. And one of the things about New York is we have a whole lot of landmarks in this theater, in this city. You know, you go to Cooperstown, New York, they've got the Baseball Hall of Fame, right? In New York, we got Radio City, we got Madison Square Garden, we got the Barclays, we got Statue of Liberty, Yankee Stadium, what have you, okay? Now, and the Apollo Theater. Now, when you think about all those other landmark places, how often have you had the opportunity to go to another landmark free of charge to have a discussion like this about community issues, free of charge, with the type of talent that's on this stage? Like, this is part of what we do to give back to this community. But what we're going to ask in return is I'm going to ask for respect for the panelists. Now, the Apollo Theater has always been known for having a spirited audience. But this theater is not about bullying people, okay? There's a difference between cheering and stuff and bullying somebody. And what really makes me upset about it, y'all, is as the producer of this event, I will tell you straightforward, the sellouts who you should be mad at ain't walking on this stage to begin with. I couldn't book them. So what you're doing, you have every right to be upset. I'm upset. But what you're doing is you're taking it out on the people who took the time to come here on a Saturday to speak to y'all and to get your input. So if you're the, so that's enough said on that. Last thing on that is, yeah, we've been asking for your questions, which you were able to do. They're being incorporated as we speak. You had a chance to submit questions when you registered. You can still submit questions through social media. We're going to get your questions, and we're going to put in as many as possible. But if we're spending time debating with y'all as you shout over each other, that just means the questions that were submitted don't get to be asked. So please just show respect. Even if you disagree, just give them that much respect. That's all we're going to ask for, all right? You got questions, just submit them online. We're going to get to as many as we can, okay? All right, on that note, New York, our next guest is taking the stage for the first time ever as an Apollo Uptown Hall panelist. However, it's not the first time that he's taking the stage for an Apollo Uptown Hall. He was here last year as a performer for Apollo Uptown Hall exploring MLK's Two Americas. Let's take a look at him in action.
Thank you, sir.
Wow. You know? Wow.
Word.
And I like your haircut, too, man.
Thank you, sir. You know what I'm saying?
Hot.
I just try
that's
to pattern
hot.
After the best. You know,
I mean?
You know how that goes.
So we've heard a lot about MOVE. We talked about it
in
the first few segments. But a lot of people outside of Philadelphia, where I'm from, don't know a lot about the story of MOVE and the catastrophe of those 11 lost lives that day.
Yeah.
And so we know the story needs to be told.
Mm-hmm.
But why in an opera?
Ha. Well, a couple of things. The first is, first of all, peace. How y'all doing? the opera is not about MOVE. The opera is about five kids from North Philadelphia who get in trouble in North Philly and decide that the only place that they're safe is in another part of the city, and they decide that it is better for them to learn from the ghosts that live in the ashes of the MOVE house than it is from their own public school. So this opera isn't about MOVE, this opera is about America and about the future shadow of what happened on May 13th, 1985. We have a pathology in this country, as many of you know, which is we are ahistorical. You know, folks forget what happened earlier today. Folks have, might have made a Facebook post yesterday, and that history is forgotten today. So these kids are living in the shadow of a profound and diabolical history. They are the products of a system that hunts them, and the opera is situated in that reality.
Yeah. Okay. We have a question from a listener from URD. Eric B. of West Philadelphia asks, I'm an artist, so I understand art is meant to evoke passion, but is it exploiting the tragedy by putting music and dance to it?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. You know, in conversations with Ramona Africa and Sue Africa prior to composing the work, they were very clear that what was most important to them was that we not disparage the name of John Africa or his teachings. And we tried to create a work that was deferential and respectful both to John Africa and his teachings and also to the city, folks in the city of Philadelphia who experienced the trauma together. I would not use the word exploit. I would say that our histories need to be animated, that we have to connect to these really critical and pivotal moments in our common history and not relive them, not reimagine them, and certainly not profit off of them in egregious ways. But unless we're going to maintain a dialogue, there are thresholds that surround this country and our ways of being here that we're never gonna cross, we're never gonna break. So art is, as the great Fela says, music is the weapon.
So you've mentioned the word history a few times.
Yes.
And history is an interesting thing.
Yeah.
Because it tends to repeat itself.
Yeah.
What do you hope that people will learn from the history that you share through this opera about what happened with MOVE?
That's a great question. I saw a meme not too long ago, and I think it was attributed to Jesse Williams, but the words were, racism is so American that when we protest racism, the average American thinks we're protesting America.
I saw that today. Yeah.
Yeah. Think about how embedded these pathologies are in a way of being, in a way of conversing, in a way of finding solution.
Yeah.
And think about how we dismantle these pathologies that are so deeply interwoven. And you know, these are the materials that are the architecture of the United States of America. Hypermilitarism, hypercapitalism, sexism, and white supremacy. So if our political leaders clearly are not providing the language for us to dismantle these pathologies and systems, so who does? It's the artists among us. I believe it's all of us as community who are connected to the creative enterprise. Literally, you know, I have a 15-year-old son. And he says to me the other day,
I have a 15-year-old daughter.
Oh, so
we can console each other later.
All right. Bet. I have a 15-year-old son, I have a 12-year-old daughter, and we were at dinner together the other night, and my son was talking about being a visionary. He's a musician, and he's 15, so you know, he thinks he's a visionary. He's like, man, nobody hears the music that I hear in my head. You know what I mean? And I love that strut. I love that swagger. Just like he's inconsolable in his belief in his own imagination. You know what I mean? And I'm like, okay, cool. So you not there, but the fact that you think you headed there means I'm doing an okay job.
Right.
Because I'm nurturing the creative spirit within my 15-year-old brown boy. So if our political leaders aren't doing it, then the artists among us have to.
Right.
And that's what I seek to do in the work that I do.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The interesting thing about African Americans, and you see it throughout the history that you've alluded to in our conversation, is that we tend to create the trends. We tend to create the bedrock of the culture, right? Mm-hmm, we tend to create all of these things that other people have traditionally made money from and not us.
Yeah.
So how do you hope this creativity that you're nurturing, not only through this work, but also in your children, how do you hope this creativity will move us forward now as a people?
One of my favorite lines in this opera, and I hope for those of you that have the opportunity to come next weekend, I hope you come through, but one of my favorite lines in the opera is, love is the only word sweeter than black.
Mm.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. The phrase is, say black and hear yes. Say black and hear enough. Say love is the only word sweeter than black. I hope that just becomes like normal out here.
We need to put it on a t-shirt right now.
You know what I mean?
Right now, bro.
The great Alicia Garza speaks about this. The movement for Black Lives is a love movement. That's something that Dr. King talked about and many others. So what I hope becomes normalized is this alignment with love and blackness, because we are the salt of the earth.
Absolutely. So, absolutely.
Yes.
Brother Mark Bamuti. Man, thank you, brother.
Thank you, family.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Harlem. Thank you, Apollo, for having me out here. I appreciate it.
So, look, y'all, we've talked about it, but the Apollo audience is known for judging for themselves, as I saw earlier. So we're going to give y'all a peek of We Shall Not Be Moved. It is coming here next week.
You don't have to trust.
Yeah. Special. Special. Well, audience, we've gotten Bamuthi's perspective, and it was a perspective, wasn't it? Give that brother some acknowledgement and some love. Excellent. And applause. Excellent. Yeah. We're going to expand the conversation now. Last night, I had an opportunity in my radio GBE broadcast to talk with this brother, and I said to him when we were talking backstage, I said, brother, it wasn't long enough. We have to come back again and stretch him, and we will have him back in our broadcast.
Oh, thank you.
His name is Michael O'Brien. Give him a big round of applause, first of all.
Thank you.
Brother Michael works in Philadelphia for Project Smash. It is one of several different crowns that he wears.
Thank you.
As an advocate for youth rights and social change. And one of the great things as well is that he has a very special sense of understanding of the use of art as a tool. Brother Michael, talk about what you do.
Sure, yeah. Well, so first off, thank you for those kind words. Thank you to the Apollo and Ade for putting this on. I can't believe I'm on stage next to the log. that's so dope. I grew up watching it on TV. But to the point, right, what art as a tool, really, I think about art and my work as a tool for healing, a tool for protection, a tool for growth. I think some of the smartest people on the planet, and that's not to disrespect anybody who's around us right now, but I think some of the smartest people lived like 1,500 or more years ago. Mm. And when we look at the indigenous world and we look at people who practiced before capital became something we cared the most about, healing and the idea of growth and joy through the arts was just embedded at so many touch points in a day. Mm. And when you multiply that day across the developmental lifespan, you had so much access to growth, healing, and protection, and relationships with adults. Right, relationships with adults that cared about you, who could help indoctrinate you to strength-based practices that helped you develop into the genius, right, that you truly are, and invite that genius to come out and to be engaged in the community and integrated into the community. And so that is the perspective I take on my work. That's the perspective I use with art in the context of communities that have been suffering from historical trauma, disinvestment, a number of the issues that some of the prior folks spoke about. And so my work really centers around getting people to believe that they can be who they want to really be,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Particularly when life has kind of pushed you against too many walls and it's easier to disconnect than to believe in that person that you can see but don't know how to close the gap to get there. And the other piece is that, again, art gets people to experience joy in their own personal narratives while being able to work out the meaning of what's happened to them at the same time. Joy doesn't have to be an isolated experience.
Your response actually bleeds into the next question. Valerie Denise from the Bronx asks, what is your view on the importance of arts in terms of dealing with our youth?
Yeah, so I think we have enough scientific research to actually start a new dialogue around art. I see art as a biological requirement for young people, for people. But I think now we have enough proof that bioethically to deny young people art is to actually deny the best trajectory for development or one of the best tools for development.
Yeah.
Thank you. You know, just a quick example, last year some research came out around stress reduction and art making, and to me the most amazing part about that was for the folks that didn't enjoy the art making process, it still biologically reduced, the process still biologically Wow. reduced cortisol levels in the body, right? And these stress chemicals that over time in the body are absolutely poisonous, stress is not good for us beyond 20-minute spurts, right? Mm-hmm. And so when we live in environments that promote toxic stress in the body because it's relentless, right? You're parenting alone, or no matter how much money you have, right? Parenting alone is a problem,
yes.
right? Because we need more than just one or two parents or adults in a young person's life, right? Whether you are dealing with a grave illness in the family, intergenerational caregiving, these are things that are chronic and relentless. There's no like way out of them. There's no magic swipe of the wand. And then you've got the other side, which are the traumas, right? The experiences, whether they're physical or emotional experiences that really threaten your well-being. They make you feel terrified, helpless, like you have a lack of control. When you're living in that constant like chaos and then that nexus between those two categories, our expectations have to shift a little bit. People need the space for joy Absolutely. To heal, and they need to process. And art can do so much of that.
So
sorry that was so long.
Y'all see why I want this brother back, right? For real. Let's hear it for Sister Aisha Sekou. Sister is from right here in Harlem, and she is the founder and CEO of Street Corner Resources. Aisha, I know that your mission, and I want to quote it for our audience today, is to create a more peaceful community. You all take to the corners, and you are a resource to help our youth to learn to de-escalate conflicts. Street Corner Resources has been doing this work since 2005, but I'm trying to understand this connection to you having an artist cafe and a recording studio. How do those artistic components factor into what your mission is?
Okay, so first, Brother Byrd, one, it's wonderful to grace the stage of the Apollo Theater, and I would be remiss if I didn't thank Brother Ade, who has provided many opportunities for young people who are at the highest risk of shooting, for them to get an opportunity to be in the Apollo.
Yes,
and I must also thank our Cure Violence family, those of you who have supported us in having 335 days within the most hardened area here in West Harlem with no shooting. So I want to thank my team, Speak Peace Forward.
Yeah.
They're here today.
Yeah.
So I also have to say, just for clarity, is that Street Corner Resources is one of the most recent recipients in the last 2 years with a Cure Violence contract. Mm-hmm. And so we look at
Say that
violence.
Again. What kind of contract?
We have a Cure Violence contract. It's out of the mayor's office on criminal justice. Mm-hmm. And what Cure Violence is that we look at violence as an infectious disease, that when there is one act of violence, that act will begin to spread and replicate because people retaliate. So when we talk about music, and I'll bring it back to the music without spending too much time on Cure Violence, those of you that are interested can go to cureviolence.org and read more about our model. But using music, we have to understand that we work with the highest risk, the one who has the highest potential to shoot. And so my first thinking was, and even before we had a Cure Violence contract, was how do we attract these young people? How do we get them? And we know that the rap game is strong.
Okay.
That's where young people get their rap. Are we telling them to make a career out of it? No. We're trying to get them in the room. The important thing is really not about the music. I know that there are a lot of arts programs, that are focused on the music. We're focused on saving lives. reducing shootings, de-escalating violence, and intervening, and having a place where young people can come to create, one, a reputation, right? Because you get in there and you can really turn it up a little bit, learn how to engineer, learn how to take your words and create positive messages, that if we begin to control the message, control some of the things that they say and they do, and we have that highest risk person in the room, we can control some of the things that happen back on the street. So that's what music studios do. We see that the arts were removed from the schools.
Yes.
And that means that our kids don't have a place to express. And so self-expression has become something else. And even resolving conflict and disagreement happens in our music studio. They learn how to do that. And so the reason why we have the studio, so the place they show up, and I'll give you a quick example, when Eric Garner was killed.
Yes, okay.
Young men came in the studio, heated. Yo, Miss Aisha, we need to go do something. They were ready to literally take to the street. And sometimes the best thinking of a 16 and 17-year-old is not that great because they don't have consequential. No, for real, 16,
for real.
17,
just
they don't have
real.
Consequential thinking.
Yeah.
Just look, the kids who are filling Rikers Island are getting 25 years for not being able to think about consequences.
That's right.
So with this discussion about the actions that they wanted to take, it happened inside the music studio. And we were able to let them vent and begin to talk about how they were feeling, begin to look at where they can put that energy and how they can use music to create themes around what happened and begin to self-express rather than go and act out and end up arrested. So we have to talk about activism even through music.
Give sister some love. Isn't that fantastic? For real. And you can really hear the connection between what Brother Michael is laying down and what our sister is saying, the dynamics of what happens with our youth in terms of the importance of the arts, but using in this case as a tool and as a weapon for their empowerment. Rachel Shapiro, you're the Manhattan Borough Arts Director for the Office of Arts and Special Projects within the New York City Department of Education.
Got it right.
All right. It's understating the fact to say really that our schools are not funded the way that they should be. Many of us grew up in scenarios where, I mean, I grew up having a trumpet and a trombone and, you know, being in an orchestra and so forth, and those days have long gone in many cases. And it seems to many of us that during times of economic distress, the first thing that tends to get cut back is really the arts. And I'm guessing really based on your title, that's really not something that you actually support.
No, definitely not. Well, what I will say, one of the main things that I do in my job is I support all of the schools in Manhattan, pre-K to 12, in building and sustaining arts programs. I would not be sitting here in this position if it weren't not for this current administration who gave $24 million to the DOE, specifically earmarked for the Office of Arts. So we are at an all-time high right now in terms of arts funding in the New York Department, New York NYC DOE. However, to your point, it's not enough. It's never enough. And we rely on a model that combines both licensed arts teachers and cultural organizations around the city to provide arts teaching and learning to our students. So like the Apollo, many of the other organizations are also pushing into our schools. But I will say, I pulled some stats. I wanted to look at where we were with the actual hiring of teachers, and I looked at District 5, which is this community where Apollo is situated. Mm-hmm. And out of the 29 schools, there's 22 of them have licensed art specialists on 22 out of 29, okay. Which you know is not perfect, right? But the trajectory of where we're going right now is that arts teacher hiring is on a very major upswing.
I see.
We have probably close to 3,500 teachers in the system citywide. It's 1.1 million students. The arts office that I'm a part of for many years consisted of 7 people supporting 1.1 million students and 1,800 schools. Ooh. So we're now in 32 people in the arts office. So, you know, we're going in the right direction.
How do you feel that art in the schools benefits not only the students? We're clear about that. But what about how it benefits ultimately communities at large?
So I think when I think about arts education or arts experiences, I think about it in sort of 3 distinct categories: creating art, perceiving art, and performing art. So creating art, which is making something that wasn't there before, perceiving, you know, the art that somebody else has made, and performing, you know, the show or the music that somebody else has written. And when you engage in those 3 ways, you experience different kinds of skills and capacities, and we talk a lot about the capacities that art builds in people. But then when you think about, you're asking about the community and social justice, if you don't have a place or you're not being asked to identify your feelings or your ideas or your perception about the world in which you live, if you're not even asked to do that, there's no way that you can express it. Mm-hmm. And so I think we talk a lot about having a school community which starts within the school and builds. One of the stories that one of my colleagues likes to say is nobody, you know, parents don't come to school for report cards. Parents come to school for performances. Wow. Right? So that's what brings the community together.
Absolutely. Jason, I'm coming to you next because we all saw earlier that you are a filmmaker. We get that. But really, like Rachel, you have a point of view when it comes to arts and education. And I speak specifically about your role as an associate professor at George Washington University School of Media and Public Affairs. What do you pick up from what Rachel is saying? Yes. What do you pick up on what Rachel is saying?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of wisdom is being shared here, and it's amazing to be a part of. I relate to all of the comments getting here. I guess it's hard to know what to add, really. People are pretty on point, but we were talking, Michael and I, just before we came up, about the MOVE incident and the limits around what we think of understanding, right? And that when you start to study something like this, there's the hunger to get the key piece of information that's going to unlock it, and then you'll understand, and then you dig, and that never happens. And then you realize maybe you don't want that. Do you want to come to peace with this? Do you want to reach a point where you're okay with it?
Mm.
And you realize it's not an intellectual pursuit in that way. And I think that's another way that maybe hasn't come up quite yet, that an artistic response can be valid, because it is based on authenticity and integrity and a personal perspective, and doesn't require that you tighten all the screws and say exactly this is what this means.
So we saw the 2 clips from your documentary, and I know it's probably easy for a lot of us, if we're looking through television and if you're not a part of the media, to actually forget that documentaries are really art. You know, in reality, you have to have music scored, you got to curate the footage, as you were talking about earlier, and most of all, you have to tell a story. So, I mean, do you see yourself as an artist?
You know, it's so interesting, and I relate to what's being said as an educator and as an individual, because I didn't come to see myself as an artist until I was on the cusp of completing the film, and it like happened to me, like in a very clear way, and I understood it in my late 30s for the first time, and I started to understand what it meant to be an artist, and I started to consider myself an artist. But it was only through this project that I came to that personal growth, which is exactly how it was defined and exactly what it was.
So how does that then, in seeing yourself as an artist, connect to a commitment to social change?
Yeah, well, I think what's interesting as both a teacher and an artist is to understand how they can contribute to each other, and that sometimes the best teaching you can do is by example, and to hear students that I'm very proud of, you know, present their own work and say, not that I taught them everything they know, but they were inspired by my work to do their own work.
Mm.
That, and it's part of the other question too, because I didn't understand that until I heard it out of a young person's mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? And then I was like, okay, I'm learning something here, and I'm doing some good work. Mm. So it's deep.
Wow.
It's deep.
I've been waiting to talk to you, Bamuthi, because as a brother who's a lyricist and has had an opportunity of being in that field and endeavor, when I was reading about your work, leading to where we are now and what you're doing, there was a question that I said, I know I have to ask you this because I'm sure brothers and sisters who are not familiar with opera don't necessarily get what that is. We know if you say lyricist, we get that, you know, and lyricist, composer goes together. But you're doing something else that connects to that, but talk about the distinction between a librettist and a lyricist.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been waiting to ask that.
So that's great. That's great. So, confession, I don't really like opera. because it's never, I'm not a big opera fan. Because
yeah.
For the most part, it doesn't reflect not just my reality, but my aesthetics and sensibility.
Yeah.
So, I can't curse, right? But I refer to the thing that we made as opera black as
okay.
Because it's opera the way that we make it.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
So you know, here's the thing just in general about and it was mentioned earlier. We are creators, we are innovators.
Absolutely.
Not just as a kind of cultural trope or cultural mechanism, but mm-hmm. our survival has been dependent on innovation, on taking traditional forms or traditional objects, traditional materials, and molding them in a new way. Mm-hmm. So very often people say, people want us to conform to the status quo or to conform to existing norms. But the history of black people in this country ultimately is that people conform to us.
That's right.
And
that's
what we
right.
do
that's
and
right.
what we make.
Yeah.
That's right.
So I'm a lyricist who wrote an opera. The opera people, in order to translate it to the opera people, call me a librettist. And that's cool. I appreciate the syllables and whatnot. But I'm a translator of a particular experience who loves black people.
Mm-hmm. Well so, said, brother. Well said. You know, since we create the way we create, they call it a opera. We'll call it a our-pra. Okay.
Oh, yeah. I love that.
Okay, for real. Brother Bamuthi, this piece is coming. I'm so pleased that you made that distinction because I think there is a place where, you know, language can sometimes put people in another kind of state
yeah.
when it comes to stepping into an experience.
Sure.
And I think what you just did and some of what's been talked about what's going to be happening with We Shall Not Be Moved indicates very clearly this is something other than a, quote, opera that you would be accustomed to.
That you would be accustomed to, but I do actually think that it's important that we hold on to the word opera
uh-huh.
because it is a three-act piece that is largely driven by music.
You have a composer too. I wish you
yes,
acknowledge
yes. So, the brother in the video that was shared earlier, his name is Daniel Bernard Romaine. He
yes.
is the composer of the work. We are both children of immigrants. Both of our sets of parents are Haitian. Mm. So you have two word up Aiti Aibobo. So you have two Haitians that made an opera, that wrote the lyrics, that created the music, and you have Bill T. Jones, one of the great artists of our time,
one of the best.
That directed
right.
the opera.
Yeah.
And all of us, I would call us, we are all iconoclasts, mm-hmm. which means that we take existing structures and we don't, and we break them apart to make something else. So it is absolutely an opera, but it is an opera the way that we do it.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
So the things to hold on to, I think, in terms of being drawn to the work that we made, is that this is an opera that includes gospel, includes jazz, includes spoken word, and soulful music. There are black bodies on stage. It is one of
it is one of the rare moments, I think, in the operatic structure where we truly have bent the norms to fit our mold, and it's worth engaging in for that reason alone.
So although the title is We Shall Not Be Moved, we will be moved, in other
right
words,
on.
Right?
Yes, yes, yes.
No question. Very special, and I think that, you know, for those of you who've come today and really made your presence felt in terms of the order that Brother Ade put out there, movement required.
Yeah.
I know that it takes a great effort, you know, especially in New York, to get anywhere, okay? Yeah. And some of y'all didn't just come from around the block and all that. So we want to, first of all, give acknowledgement and thank you to all of you for coming out today. Please give yourselves a big round of applause. And also, if you appreciated the insights of our panelists, those on stage now and those who came before you, let them feel your love in an Apollo kind of way right now, if you will. Now, this is the Apollo. Y'all got to work that a little bit. I said the Apollo, okay? Come on now. All right. And since we have spent time talking about the arts and talking about the opera, it is probably only right that we give you an extra preview of what's going to be happening at the Apollo next week. Are y'all with that? You think we can do that? All right. So without any further ado, brothers and sisters, we shall not be moved.
We're going out?
Yep.
Oh, thank you. Now, I say once again, y'all got to meet some Apollo energy now. Come on now, let me feel y'all. That's right. We shall not be moved. Coming right here to the world famous Apollo Theater. Once again, I say to y'all, give yourself some energy because you came out and showed out for us today. We have had an amazing time, and at the same time, we still got some announcements that have to be made actually this evening as well. And I think I got my brothers standing by to kick it in. The illustrious Blacks, lay it down, brothers.
What's up, y'all? Once again, my name is Manchild Black.
And my name is Monster Black.
And together we are the illustrious Blacks. It's an honor to stand on the stage with you, Mr.
Yes.
Imhotep Gary Byrd.
Give thanks, brothers.
Big
thank
hero.
You. Thank you.
We want to thank you once again. First, We Shall Not Be Moved will have its New York City debut next week at the Apollo, and you don't want to miss it. So, if you show your ticket from today's Apollo Uptown Hall, when you buy your ticket at the box office, or you enter COMM, which stands for community, short for community, when you buy your tickets online or by phone, you get 20% off select We Shall Not Be Moved tickets through Monday. So remember, you know, when you buy your tickets to enter COMM, short for community, when you buy your tickets online or by phone, and you will get 20% off your tickets for We Shall Not Be Moved through Monday.
And if y'all enjoyed the clips of Let the Fire Burn, you should know two things. There are copies of the DVD on sale in the lobby that director Jason Osder will sign, so you can go get your copy signed. And also, Bamuti will be in the lobby as well.
That's right.
So you can get that signed as well, your book. So let's see. Number two. Go see it on a bigger screen. It will be screened at Maisel's Cinema on Malcolm X Boulevard at 127th Street tomorrow, October 1st at 5 p.m. And Jason will be there tomorrow as well. So take your ticket stub from today for the 10% discount there.
Right, and today's co-host Solomon Jones, prolific author, and he will be in the lobby signing copies of his books. So if you want to meet Solomon, be sure to catch him in the lobby. Imhotep will also be signing books, and CDs actually, in the lobby. CDs, we all still have those, right? Because I use them. Yeah, CDs in the lobby. So you can catch him there as well.
Yes, also catch Imhotep here on this stage, again, when he hosts the Apollo annual Kwanzaa celebration, Regeneration Night.
Oh, yes, yeah, yes. Oh, yeah.
Give it up for that. Featuring Abdel Salam's Forces of Nature Dance Theater and special guest Le Nubian. That's going to be hot. It's happening December 30th, and tickets are available right now. So get your tickets. Take it away, Solomon.
All right, yeah. All right. Thank you, Blacks. Get my hand.
Yeah.
Yo, I want to thank you guys for just having me here at the Apollo Theater. It's great being on this stage, great being in a historic place like the Apollo in Harlem, New York, and it's an honor, Imhotep Gary Byrd, being on the stage with you, my brother. You've been in radio for 50 years, and you laid the groundwork for brothers like me. So I appreciate you, man, and thank you so much for all that you have done
to
lay the groundwork, man. I stand on your shoulders, brother.
Thank you, my brother. And let's hear it for our brother for the energy that he brought today to the Apollo Uptown Hall. Very special brother as well. Well, brothers and sisters, this test on the wrap-up point. So as I always say in all of my broadcasts at WLIB, WBLS, and WBAI, the key to tomorrow is what we do today. The decision to work or whether to play. Both have their place in the human life stream, but only one will achieve your dream. As you know, life is the ultimate trip once you learn to experience. In the end, experience is the best teacher. GBE, God bless everybody. Thanks for being with us, brothers and sisters.
Good night.
Have a good night, everybody.
One last thing. The winner of the WBAI Apple Watch giveaway is
Johanna Muhammad.
Johanna Muhammad, you won the Apple Watch from WBAI, courtesy of WBAI 99.5 FM. So Johanna, go and claim your watch, and if you want to give it to me, you can.
Or you can give it to me.
Hush not, child, and don't cry. Your folks might understand you by and by. Just move on up.
Don't forget, everyone, tell everyone what they missed today.
Though you may find from time to time complication.
Don't forget.